IVM.
Just a note before you start listening, since this episode was not recorded in a studio, please excuse the sound quality.
Hello and welcome to the Ganatantra podcast. I am Saryu Natarajan.
And I am Alok Prasannakumar. Today is the first episode of our special series ahead of the 2019 general election. As we had mentioned in the previous episode, we are having special episodes before each phase of polling, looking at one particular state or one issue that cuts across the many states going to polls. In this episode, we have a very special guest. We have KK Kailash joining us.
Kailash is with the Department of Political Science at the University of Hyderabad. His research interests focus on political institutions and governance, elections, coalition politics, and processes and issues of federalism in contemporary India. He is published with a range of publications, including the Economic and Political Weekly, Seminar, India Review, Contemporary South Asia, Asian Survey, and has also contributed to numerous edited volumes. He contributes occasionally to the Indian Express and Mint. He has also been associated with Lokniti, which is the CSDS, the Program for Comparative Democracy, since 2008. He is also an honorary fellow at the Center for Multilevel Federalism at the Institute of Social Sciences, New Delhi. Before coming to Hyderabad Central University, he previously worked in Punjab University, Chandigarh. He also has a PhD from Jawaharlal Nehru University. So welcome, Kailash. It's a pleasure to have you with us.
Thank you.
So Kailash, maybe you can tell us a little bit about how you got interested in this field and the work that, and the research work that you're currently undertaking.
My interest in political parties and state politics begins with my PhD, which was on coalitions in India. Mm-hmm. I looked at the coalition formations from 1989 to the Vajpayee government, that is around 2004.
Okay.
So that's from where I got my interest into state politics and political parties.
And what spurred your interest in looking at issues of regional parties and regional politics? Because that's a theme that you have been writing about, I think, since the last, at least definitely since 2014, but a little bit before that as well.
That's because when I joined Lokniti and I started working with Lokniti, as you know, they focus on states. Mm-hmm. So along with that, every election, we choose particular themes that would interest us. And last time I thought regional political parties was something nice to work on. And that's where my paper in the EPW was on regional political parties.
All right. Let's dive straight into talking a little bit more about some of the work that you've been doing over time. Your work, early work, you said, was on coalitions and the history of coalitions. And it would be wonderful to hear from you how to think about coalition politics in a context where our incumbent government is a resounding majority, a single party majority.
Yeah. So after the 2014 election, I also had another piece in the studies in Indian politics, where I said that it's actually now become a coalitional system. So I said that early coalitions you had was some sort of, you know, things that came together after elections. It was some sort of an haphazard way of just trying to get the numbers. Over a period of time, those coalition politics evolved. Then we had these pre-electoral coalitions with proper seat arrangements. Then subsequently, once this was set up, you then move into a phase where again, you have what is called post-electoral coalitions where parties start bargaining after elections. But the entire thing is that even before elections, everybody knows that after this election, we are going to have a coalition. So that's what I called as a coalitional system.
Yeah, and everybody seems to think that coalitions politics have only come up in the last 3 decades or so. But I think at the state level, we always had a thriving coalition culture.
Yes. Kerala is a very good example of coalition politics. And I think a lot of mechanisms that coalitions at the center use or in many other states when we have coalitions use actually come from Kerala. Now, Kerala itself has gone through this long process of learning. Right. And I also said that coalitions and political parties learn over a period of time how to manage alliances. Mm. So what you see in Kerala is that after 1980 or 82, you have what is again a coalitional system, mm-hmm. where you have this alternation between the UDF and the LDF.
Right.
And there in Kerala, you also see this whole idea of coalition management. I think that started in Kerala, where they have proper management system about what should be done when political parties have differences, what should governments do and how should parties manage their differences, how are seats to be allocated, how are portfolios to be allocated. All this is sort of set up. It's institutionalized in Kerala. And we see, say, the UPA, for instance, not UPA, the United Front, for instance, draws from this Kerala experience. Then the NDA takes it over, the NDA 1 of Mr. Vajpayee, and then UPA takes it over. Then, of course, now you have the NDA 2.
And but again, I think there are some very specific circumstances where it allows for proper coalition politics. Because in Karnataka, for instance, we have had coalition governments, but they've almost always ended in tears. They've ended very badly. Even though currently we have a coalition government, it's not exactly looking like it's going to last for 5 years. The previous coalition between the BJP and the JDS fell apart again very quickly. And before that, the Congress-JDS coalition fell apart very quickly.
Karnataka definitely has a history of coalitions falling apart, at least in the recent decades.
Yeah, but it would be interesting, I guess, to think of how, you know, what are the kind of conditions which allow for proper coalition management in some way to emerge. I think Kerala is the best example of a long-standing system evolving on both sides of how to manage and run elections.
Yes. One way, if you look at Kerala again and maybe most successful coalitions at the center, what you see is that when parties are not competing with each other, especially I'm saying talking about territorial competition, that I think then allows for them to manage and stay on for a long time. So I go back to Kerala again. You can see Kerala has these distinctive communities, like you have the Hindus, the Muslims, and the Christians.
Right.
Yeah.
Now they are territorially concentrated in a particular, in some ways.
Right.
You have the Muslims in the north, and in the central and southern places, you have Christian concentrations.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, both these two religious communities have political parties which represent them, or which get most of their votes from these two communities.
Yes.
Now, what has happened in Kerala is that the two big parties actually give those regions to the smaller parties to compete.
Okay.
So when there is this non-compete sort of arrangement there, then I think it's a smooth affair subsequently.
Yeah.
So all third front governments will succeed because they're always not competing with each other. For example, a JDS in Karnataka doesn't compete with a BJD in Orissa or a Trinamool in this thing. So that's probably the easiest coalition to make because there's no give and take there and it's smooth to manage.
Yeah.
Yes. So there's no trade-off or there's no competition between these parties themselves in any measure.
Yeah.
And it's very easy to withdraw from a contest. Like, for instance, the BSP, if it is in a coalition, can very easily withdraw from areas where they have no strength at all.
Yeah.
And the vote transfer would therefore take place. Is that the implication then, Kailash?
Yes. So where you want to bridge your spatial gaps or territorial gaps that you have, that's where it will succeed. So the first NDA, for instance, Vajpayee, when they did not have these, they didn't have just like what it is now, but where they had large gaps in the east and the south. So they played the small partner. And that sort of, I think, let the BJP succeed and the NDA actually do very well. The NDA 1.
Right.
Whereas the NDA 2, we see a difference where the BJP has got ambitious. Now, BJP wants to, you know, replace first the Congress and then the regional political parties and to get this all India presence. That's where I think the tensions lie. You can see what has happened in Maharashtra with the Shiv Sena. You see what's happening in Punjab with the Akali Dal.
And to some extent with BJD in Orissa as well.
Yes.
So they can't possibly form a coalition there because they see each other as competition, right?
For each other, for the same space.
Right.
But even the BJP, if you ask me, seems to be learning because the NDA in, say, ahead of 2019, at least as of when this podcast is being recorded, have conceded quite a few more seats than they did the last time. For instance, with the JDU, I think they have been happy to give up some of the seats in Bihar in the hope of better performance. So I guess, and likewise, perhaps across the Northeast as well. So,
and it seems also the Congress is adopting a fairly thoughtful strategy. I don't know if one can call it that, in that they're contesting the least number of seats that they have ever contested.
Yeah.
Okay. The BJP, whether it's learning, yes, but I think it still has these big aims that of covering the entire country. So I think this is a short-term adjustment for both in Bihar and the Northeast.
Fair enough.
And what about the Congress? Any reflections on that?
The Congress, of course, it must be compete. It is competing a small number of seats compared to the past, but I'm not sure where it is going with the current alliances that it has made, especially in UP, where I'm not sure whether it should have given up a little more accommodating.
Fair enough.
Or unless there is some unwritten arrangement that they have to cut votes and seats in the state.
That's fair enough. So I think we can now also sort of dive headlong into Telangana, where clearly, I mean, just for context, I suppose our listeners will know that Telangana has sort of broke from the tradition of having elections along with the Lok Sabha elections.
Hardly a tradition.
Well, at least in the last few election cycles, when Telangana and Andhra would go into polls with the Lok Sabha polls. And I guess people were looking forward to see how Telangana and Andhra would play out. But we have now just seen that the assembly polls have taken place. The TRS, the Telangana Rashtra Samiti, has come back to power with an even bigger majority. And I was just reading, Kailash, your piece in Indian Express, where I think you mentioned that K Chandrasekhar Rao is possibly the shrewdest political entrepreneur in India today. I mean, that sort of intrigued me, because we do see a lot of success, examples of successful state-level politicians. You know, it immediately comes, Naveen Patnaik comes to mind, Mamata Banerjee comes to mind. But I just thought we could sort of go a little bit in depth as to why you think KCR is the shrewdest of the lot.
KCR is what why I call him shrewd is, I think, that he's played all sides. He's sort of kept some space for the BJP subsequent after 2019. Then he can also play the secular front, because he's moved along. He's gone to West Bengal. He's gone to Orissa. He's gone to Tamil Nadu. He's gone to UP. So he's touched all these regional political party leaders. So he's kept himself open. But more importantly, I think his move for the early elections in 2018, last year, I thought that was something like what Mrs. Gandhi did in the 1970s.
Okay.
Where, by cutting the link between the national and the state elections, he puts the spotlight completely on himself.
Right.
And then sort of he knows that the BJP is dependent on Modi. And if you were to have the elections together, then the focus would be on Modi and the BJP. And in a way, this sort of cuts the BJP's... BJP doesn't have the advantage now in, if you were to have it separately. Right. So there is two separate elections and the focus is on him. And at that point of time, I think the Congress also was gradually getting its act together. It was getting some sort of an opposition movement in place. So he sort of, I think, saw all this and suddenly decided to have these elections early.
Right. Also, I think it made sense from his perspective not to be tied up not just with the image of Modi, but with the issues that were going to be discussed in the elections in 2019.
Yes. By cutting himself from the 2019 election, I said it focuses on him and all his programs, which he had been doing for the past 4 years.
So if we could take a little bit of a segue into welfare here and the programs of KCR, could you tell us a little bit more about what the focus was in the in the assembly election campaign in Telangana, and also what lessons does that tell us about welfare at the state level in general?
Okay, so there were two issues, if you remember, the campaign for Telangana itself. One was that Telangana is that United Andhra, which was not having much access to irrigation. So, and it's a place where it's dependent on rainfall and therefore it's sort of drought-prone parts of Andhra Pradesh. So the campaign was that most of the water is being diverted into the now Andhra Pradesh and it should actually be coming into these parts. So once he comes to power, what he does is that he's focused completely on, has a lot of focus on irrigation. And he has this, he had this scheme called Mission Kakatiya. Okay, so this Mission Kakatiya is basically to restore all tank and irrigation which was there not unused or which had to be redug and cleaned up, and so that they could hold more water over a period of time. The second issue that he had with regard to water was something called Mission Bhagiratha, which was to provide clean drinking water to different parts of the state. Now, if you have been following news, then these two programs have also received a lot of national and international attention. And if you look at the spending that the government has done with regard to, let's say, both with regard to, let me just talk about irrigation, for instance. like if you were to, it's like the All India average, I believe, is around 4.5% of the budget. Mm-hmm. Whereas Telangana has spent during the period, say from 2015 to 2019, mm-hmm. 14% of its budget has gone into irrigation.
Wow.
Okay.
Yeah. Interesting.
That's impressive. Yeah.
So he's actually delivered when it comes to these, when it comes to water. Now let's see when, if there is a monsoon shortfall and how these actually work out. But over the past, during his term, I think people have been generally happy with what he has been done with regard to irrigation. Now I'll just move to agriculture. Mm-hmm. Now, again, look at the spending which he has done with regard to agriculture. Now, you look at budgets, All India average state spending for budget is around 6.2%. Telangana is marginally higher with 7.8% budget actually going to agriculture.
And this excludes irrigation and things like that, right?
Yeah, this is separate from irrigation.
Yeah.
So, he's focused on that. Then, of course, the most famous scheme was his Raitu Bandhu scheme, where he gives money to farmers. For if you want a particular mm-hmm. amount of land, you get this fixed amount of money, which the Prime Minister then replicates with the 5,000 or 6,000 rupees scheme, which was announced sometime back.
Yeah.
This is with regard to irrigation and agriculture. Now, if you look at his focus on welfare.
Right.
Yeah.
And again, with regard to, say, the scheduled castes and scheduled tribe communities, mm-hmm. again, spending is dramatically high compared to All India levels. Mm-hmm. All India level would be around 2.93%. He's spending around 8.5% of his budget only for these communities. Okay, so he's done work. The groundwork is done. He has a lot of money to spend thanks to Hyderabad. And he's been putting it into these main three areas which I just spoke of: irrigation, agriculture, and welfare.
And I guess I suppose that also has borne fruits for him, right?
Yes. That's the 2018 December election, I think, was just, he's just reaping the benefit of all that spending.
Yeah.
And remember that Telangana is also a revenue surplus state when it started.
Right.
Yes.
So he has a lot of space for spending.
Right.
But over the past 4 or 5 years, I think that space is narrow, is coming down.
Okay.
So I'm not sure whether he'll be able to maintain this subsequently.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And there we would see some sort of backlash coming up.
Okay. Because the thing, I mean, this is something it just occurred to me, because now that you were mentioning spending, Telangana is also one of those states which is not very heavily dependent on the center's transfer its share in central taxes. It actually generates quite a bit of its own revenue. But again, this is pre-GST, as I remember the numbers. So maybe that is something that might impact the way in which Telangana has this fiscal space, so to speak, to implement its projects. But even then, I think what's one thing having the money, and I suppose the key point that you're making is that he knew how to spend that money. He knew how to spend that money to have the kind of results he did for the elections. But another point that we were sort of coming to is, how sustainable would this be? I mean, is this something that it's going to be his next 5 years as well, since he's in power?
And also, how is his narrative shaped up in this current election?
Yeah.
Are there any other different issues that are popping up? Is there a resonance of some of the bigger themes that we are seeing at the national level, such as nationalism and jobs, that also resonates or is being brought up in the Telangana elections as well, or the Telangana leg of this?
Okay, so I'll just take the first question first. That is, if you again look at the economic statistics that keep coming out and the CMIE, this thing, which shows that Telangana has actually not been able to attract much investment compared to, let's say, Andhra Pradesh over the past 4 years.
Okay,
so this is like, for instance, under Naidu has actually been doing much, much better compared to Telangana when it comes to at least industrialists committing to invest.
Right.
I'm not sure how much of this money has actually come in, but at least the commitments, Andhra has got much more than Telangana.
Mm-hmm.
So if this is an indicator, then I think slowly or gradually, we are Hyderabad or Telangana might not be as attractive as it is currently.
Okay.
And this then might go on to reduce his sort of fiscal space.
Okay.
And then coming on to the question about other issues in this election. If you remember the latest that ADR governance survey that came up, like all other places in Telangana also, the issue was unemployment.
Right.
And the Telangana movement, I remember, was based on students' movement. It was all student-based. Students participated in large numbers.
Yeah.
And there was this in the campaign rhetoric that once we come to power, we meaning I mean Telanganites come to power, we will be able to give more jobs to people from Telangana who are from Telangana. And the people who have been eating up those jobs are the people from Andhra side. Now, once they go, these jobs are ours for our people. But he has just not been able to provide that type of employment for all those people. And that's where there is some sort of unhappiness among the youth. But with these grand spending patterns that he has, that has sort of been muscled. Yeah, so that's with regard to the employment. Now, I can talk a little bit, if you want, about his how he has sort of neutralized the BJP also in these 5 years.
Sure. No, that would be interesting to hear.
I think that is the most natural next question as well.
Yeah. So, during this particular period, with the money that he has, he's been also giving a lot of money to community-based institutions. He's been giving money to temples. He's been conducting a lot of these religious functions, yagnas and other sort of activities. Okay, and he most recently actually questions the BJP that, who are you to teach us Hinduism?
Okay.
So we know our Hinduism, and he spoke of the Ram temple, and he says that you don't have any monopoly over Hinduism. Even I can, and he's also demonstrated it over the past 5 years with his, you know, he's got this religious image on him. He does has all these functions. If you see his hands, they will have a lot of these religious threads on his hands.
Okay.
So there
okay.
is this thing. So he's neutralized the BJP as well, because you can't call him anti-Hindu or something to that effect.
Sorry to interrupt. Is the revival of the Batukama festival and all of that part of some of this image of building up of the image around Hinduism?
I think it has two parts to it. One is that, remember, the Telangana movement was also a movement to reclaim what they call as Telangana identity, Telangana culture, Telangana language, and therefore Telangana festival.
Right.
Okay, and his daughter, I think, was part of, this is the MP, Ms. K. Kavita, who was leading a cultural forum during the Telangana movement. So I think the revival of these Telangana festivals like Batukunama, etc., has to do with the Telangana identity, the cultural identity. And of course, it helps him in the religious sphere as well.
Yeah. So, and I guess that's kind of interesting in the sense that he has a local answer to a national issue, if we want to call it. Because I guess, and as you pointed out, it's a fusion of two separate things. It's not just saying that, you know, I'm also a Hindu and I challenge you in this way, but I have a slightly different take on Hinduism, which is very local, rooted in the local culture, in the local history and so on. And that has been brought to the front by as part of the Telangana movement itself. And I guess he was also part, I mean, a very significant part of the Telangana movement as well, if we recall. There was also the Telangana TJS, the Telangana Jana Samiti, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
So there is some, with I would call it, not a breakaway, but some sort of backlash, I suppose, once he's taken power from within the movement.
So this movement, the TJS is led by Professor Kodan Ram. And Professor Kodan Ram is this, let's say, the idealist in the movement, who sort of expected like that when the party comes to power, it will start fulfilling all its promises, whether it's with regard to this cultural angle, whether it's regard to employment, whether it's regard to center-state relations. So there was this idealism in Professor Kodan Ram. He happens to be a political science professor as well. So you can see a parallel with let's say, the TGS being formed out of the TRS movement, the Telangana movement, and also, let's say, the breakaway of, say, Yogendra Yadav from AAP.
Yes.
So you can see there are a lot of parallels here, that they believe that these parties, which they have sort of been involved in, have moved away from their ideals.
Right.
Yes.
So the TJS of Kodan Ram represents that.
Is the TJS, therefore, is some of the concerns that the TJS has being vented out in any political forum, in the sense that do they contest in elections and do they have any electoral impact in that sense?
Unfortunately, they do not have that impact, because even if you looked at their December 2018 election, they had some sort of an understanding with the Congress.
Right.
And even now, there is, officially there's no alliance, but they are, of course, I think supporting the Congress along with the CPI, CPM and the TDP.
And that sort of actually brings me to another point that I sort of wanted to discuss. We have seen that between 2014 and 2018, the TRS has actually managed to increase its representation in the assembly. We have seen even post the 2018 elections, there have been a lot of defections from Congress to TRS. I think some 7 or 8 MLAs, if I'm not mistaken, have defected in the last few months to the TRS. It seems to me as if there isn't anything like a real opposition in Telangana.
Yes, I think this is one of the dangers that we need to look out for, and we need to at least talk about it, is that in the first assembly after the 2014 elections, around 27 MLAs have defected from both, including the Congress and the TDP, into the TRS.
Yes.
So by the end of his term, he actually has around 94 seats. That means of 117 seats of people who have gone in. Now, this has been possible because of the role played by the Speaker.
Mm-hmm.
The Speaker has not sort of invoked the anti-defection law, but has just kept allowing one after the other to get into the come to the TRS. So you have around 20 from the Congress and the rest from TDP.
Yeah.
Now, after 2018 elections, I think around 10 people from the Congress have actually shifted to the TRS. And you also have 4 members from the Legislative Council also who have shifted to the TRS.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And this is one of the reasons why the TDP says that we're not contesting here.
Mm.
They think that this is unfair.
Yeah.
Yes.
But the TDP is hardly the one to complain, because I think they've been doing the same thing in Andhra, right?
Exactly. They have done the same thing there, where they have got people from the YSRCP and the YSRCP into the TDP.
Yeah.
So what the problem with this in the long run will be that if you do not have an opposition, at least a parliamentary opposition, you are actually opening up space for non-parliamentary opposition to come up.
Mm.
And that is not something I think these parties are expecting or actually look forward, will not want it. That's something unexpected and an unwanted opposition coming up, which might then be very difficult to handle.
Could you talk about that a little more? Like, what forms do you mean, and what could the implications be?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's say that, this is hypothetical, okay? Like, say, for example, let's say these students who have been promised jobs, and you are not able to deliver employment opportunities for them. And what would they then do? They're going to be alienated.
Mm-hmm.
And let's say somebody then just moves on to taking up some sort of violent action.
Mm.
And yes,
the state already has had a moment of the Naxalite movement is there. You have a strong presence of Maoists in certain parts of the United Andhra Pradesh. Now, it's easy catchment, right? So they could just take up some non-parliamentary opposition, and you're not prepared for it. And this is unexpected.
And this also sort of, I mean, just to round out this discussion, and I think for those of you who are listening, as of recording this, the issue is actually pending in the Supreme Court, whether the Speaker can be directed by the courts to take a decision. And I think this is also one of the issues to be kept in mind, that if the Speaker undermines the entire concept of an opposition in the Assembly, you're leaving open for non-parliamentary methods, so to speak, for where people vent out their anger and frustration. If there isn't an option for them, or if they don't see a realistic option of parliamentary methods, giving an opportunity for them to air their grievances. And so we just also want to, on the question of Telangana, since we also very briefly mentioned it, Andhra has, of course, I think only recently been separated. But how do you sort of see what has happened in Andhra in the last 5 years? Now, in 2014, Chandrababu Naidu was part of the NDA. He won alongside the NDA. Midway through, he quits. He says, I didn't get special status and therefore I'm quitting. How do we make sense of that? And what do you think, how much do you think of a role do you think that will play in the upcoming elections?
Okay. Let's go back to the relationship with the BJP.
Right.
Now, if you look at the vote share in the 2014 elections, there's only 0.3% which separates YSRCP from the TDP.
Just the TDP, yes. Not the NDA, right?
No, it's the TDP vote percentage and the YSRCP vote percentage.
Okay, of course, okay.
It's,
but TDP, the conversion into seats was higher for them.
Yes, TDP was part of the NDA.
Yeah. Yes.
Now, the BJP has over, I think it's again the plan, is that it wants somewhere to get rid of all its allies.
Okay.
And come on its own. So, between 2014 and 2019, you would have seen Maharashtra, they faced a lot of problems with the Shiv Sena.
Yes.
Yes.
The elections, they went separately, then they came together and the Shiv Sena played the opposition in Maharashtra.
Yeah.
Now, in Telangana, in Andhra Pradesh also, they somewhere want to go out on their own. They want to strike it out on their own.
Uh-huh.
And therefore, Naidu was successful during the Vajpayee time because the BJP was dependent on him. And he had this large federal front where he could play around with different political parties. And he kept the BJP on a tight leash.
Yeah. Right.
Whereas that luxury he did not have in 2014 with the BJP having its numbers.
Right.
Yep.
So the BJP then, if it has this aim of building on its own in Andhra Pradesh, has somewhere cut from the TDP.
Yes.
Now it does it in two ways. One, if you remember, Venkaiah Naidu, the leader of TDP, is then made the vice president of India.
Yes.
And he was very reluctant to become the vice president of India. He wanted to still continue as in the party.
Active politics.
Yeah. Active politics, yes. Now, Mr. Venkaiah Naidu was the link between the BJP and the TDP.
Yes.
So once he becomes vice president, now Naidu has no one to actually go to. It's, you know, almost now direct connections. He has to either find direct connections or he has to work some other way. And the BJP is not cooperating with the TDP government.
Yes.
The money which is promised is not coming.
Uh-huh.
The terms of agreement as part of the Bifurcation Act are not being kept.
Mm-hmm.
And Naidu was successful in between 1999 and 2004 because he had money coming in. So whenever he needed money, the center would actually give. I can give you an example. For example, during that particular period, I think there was some 1 year was a drought year. And the central government declares Andhra Pradesh as drought prone and the Congress, which was ruling in Rajasthan at that time, doesn't get the same status.
Yes.
Okay.
And money comes to Andhra and not to Rajasthan.
Mm-hmm.
So he just doesn't have that space right now. So even money which he legitimately can claim is coming very slowly or has not come at all.
Yes.
And one of his demands, if you remember, after the 14th Finance Commission report came out, he was asking for special status.
Right.
Yes.
For Andhra, at least for some period of time. That was denied, saying that the 14th Finance Commission doesn't have a category called special status itself. So therefore, we cannot give you this such status.
And indeed, that was one of the reasons, at least declared reasons, for his exit from the NDA.
Yes. So then once you do not have the money, then how do you then deliver to people all the promises that you have made either in your elections or even while building their capital and so on and so forth? So he had to somewhere cut his ties and then have some fall guy saying that, okay, we can blame the BJP for not giving us money and play that emotional card of Andhra being discriminated by the central government, by the BJP. And play the old center-state relations card.
Hmm.
Yes.
So that's how I think he planned it out. But I'm not sure that's working the way he wanted to.
And what role has the YSRCP played in this? And how are they responding to this situation in Andhra?
The YSRCP, remember, the leader has a lot of cases against him.
Yes.
Yes.
And these cases, I believe, the center has been going slow on them.
Mm-hmm.
So once the center has been going slow on them and not actually pushing it hard, there is some sort of both Naidu also claims, the local media also keep reporting, there's some sort of an understanding between the YSRCP and the BJP.
Yes.
That for the BJP, this is a better ally than the TDP because it's a smaller ally. It's only stuck in, doesn't have that national prominence as Naidu has. And therefore he can be controlled.
Yes.
Whereas Naidu cannot be controlled given his links with other regional political parties. So they prefer to have this small party who you can control. And that's an unwritten thing. That's what comes out in the media, and it's not, there's no official alliance as such between the two.
But there's some sort of like a broad pre-poll understanding with what happens, say, once the elections are out. But here's an interesting thing, that given that Andhra, both the state assembly and the Lok Sabha elections are happening simultaneously, do you see that people might take different calls based on whether it's Lok Sabha, whether it's their MP they're voting for, whether their MLA is voting for, or do you think the pattern will more or less be identical?
I think the pattern will be identical.
Okay.
Because we are missing another player in Andhra politics. Uh-huh. That is Pawan Kalyan.
Okay.
I was just going to bring that up. How can we talk about politics without talking about Pawan Kalyan?
Yeah.
So Pawan Kalyan represents what is the Kapu community. Mm-hmm. Okay. And the Kapu community is around 15 to 17%, and they are spread across the state. Now, numerically, they are more than the other two main communities, that is the Reddis and the Kamas. Mm. But the Kapus are divided into smaller caste groups.
Right.
And their main grouse is that in spite of having these large numbers, they have been denied a due share in Andhra Pradesh. So time and again, this community has attempted to come together, but they have not succeeded, especially since the two dominant parties in United Andhra Pradesh, that is the TDP and the Congress, so almost always scuttled their attempt to come together.
Mm.
Now, one would remember that Pawan Kalyan's brother, Chiranjeevi, started what is called the Praja Rajyam Party.
Right.
Now, this Praja Rajyam Party did very well in 2009, and it took off all the anti-incumbency vote of the Congress, and thereby Naidu was not able to actually make it to form government.
Mm.
I presume that Naidu is also assuming that Pawan Kalyan will play the same role this time around by taking off the anti-incumbency vote and thereby denying the YSRCP the advantage that it would otherwise have as the main opposition party.
Ah, okay.
So that's the story about the Jansena, what Jansena could actually do in the coming elections.
And what is the voter base for the Jansena besides the Kapu community? Does Pawan Kalyan see any resonance with younger voters or any other sort of horizontal categories of voters?
He, of course, has his fans because he's known as the power star and he's a very popular movie actor. So he That's might right. get it from across different communities, from the younger lot, of course. But yeah. his main right. base would be the
That makes sense. And although, right. just to come back to Telangana right. for a little bit, one of the things that we've sort of noticed is that, and
yeah.
leading up from our discussion which we had, given that TRS has done much better in the most recent assembly elections and has increased its vote share, and given that in the last few months, we have seen, I think, about 8 or 9 MLAs have defected from Congress and other parties to the TRS, it looks like Telangana is going to be in a dangerous situation where it doesn't have an opposition to speak of.
Yes.
Okay.
Very true. I think that's a dangerous thing that is happening in both the states. Okay, like if you remember, in the after the 2014 elections, the Congress and the TDP together lost around 27 MLAs to the TRS.
Yes.
And in similarly, the YSRCP in Andhra Pradesh lost a couple of MLAs to the TDP.
Yes.
Now, in both these states, the speaker has sort of played a very partisan role,
yeah.
and actually have not worked on the anti-defection law or has just not implemented that law at all. So he just kept getting MLAs and MPs and MLAs and leaders across the getting into the TRS.
Right.
Now, the dangerous thing here is that it's happened even after the 2018 elections. And even MLCs have now shifted from the Congress to the TRS. Now, as you mentioned, yeah. the dangerous thing is that parliamentary democracy requires mm-hmm. an opposition. There has to be an opposition in parliament because the opposition acts as a, let's say, a safety valve, and therefore will be able to sort of attract all sorts of critique and criticism that the government should actually legitimately receive and hear. Once you eat up this opposition, once you don't leave any opposition, right. then the opposition will come from somewhere. There will always be opposition, and that will then be in the extra parliamentary sphere.
So you spoke of sort of extra parliamentary resistance to some of the government's imperatives in assemblies. But in the context of Telangana, there is sort of the decline or the vanishing of the opposition due to the strategies followed by these parties. But has any critique of the actions of the government come from outside, and particularly in the context of Telangana, from within the Telangana movement itself?
Yes, you have Professor Kodanram's movement, which is there. That is the Telangana Jansena.
Okay,
so that is a critique which has come from within the TRS or from within the Telangana movement itself.
Okay.
He, Professor Kodanram, believes that the TRS has not lived up to what the Telangana movement stood for, and has sort of betrayed the movement and has become like any other political party that was ruling Andhra Pradesh before or now in Telangana. So he's been a very sharp critique of the chief minister and the chief minister's methods and what the chief minister has been doing. So that's one critique that has come. But here again, the chief minister and the TRS have used very high-handed methods to actually even suppress his movement. For example, they have not allowed people to, you know, there have been usually designated places where protests and rallies, etc. are held. And the chief minister has shut all these arenas and that people have been pushed to out of the city limits to have their programs. When you cut the opposition from this thing, then we can expect something, as I said, from outside the parliamentary sphere. And I think we should look beyond the Kodanram movement for some opposition. And that's the dangerous thing which we need to be careful of.
Right. And in fact, we had this conversation a little while ago, and I think you drew a very interesting analogy between Professor Kodanram and KCR and compared it to, say, Yogendra Yadav and Arvind Kejriwal in terms of the idealists in the movement being disillusioned by the kind of compromises that politics requires.
Yes.
But before we sort of close out this conversation fully, I sort of wanted to raise one slightly provocative point. And given that, I think, except for the last 5 years or so, I think for the bulk of the last three decades, we have seen that almost no central government or no government has been possible in the Lok Sabha without the involvement of a party from Tamil Nadu, either the DMK or the AIADMK. Could it be that going forward, there is no chance of a government at the center without one of the two, or at least one party among YSRCP and the TRS? Could it be that what we're looking at is how YSRCP and TRS sort of become more prominent in national politics?
And also, I'd like to take you back, sorry, Kailash, at this juncture to some of your own work on these kinds of coalition politics and the different types of parties. And I guess in 2014, some types of regional parties did see a decline, whereas others didn't. And if you could sort of, shed light on some of these in the context of Andhra Pradesh.
Okay. Now, after the 2014 elections, I had written this paper where I made a distinction within regional political parties. I call them as regionalist political parties and regionally located political parties. So the regionalist parties are those parties which basically work on center-state relations, who talk about states' rights, who talk about protection of state culture, state language, and so on and so forth. Whereas the regionally located parties are only located within a territorial region and they do not have any regional sort of affinity there. They would like the national parties as such. For example, the Samajwadi Party or the Rashtriya Janata Dal or the JDU in Bihar. They are regionally located parties, whereas the regionalist parties are our TDP, DMK, Shiromani Akali Dal, Shiv Sena. These are the regionalist parties.
That's right.
Okay.
Now, in the 2014 elections, the BJP was able to defeat or did very well in states where you had regionally located parties, but did very poor in states where you had regionalist parties.
Right.
Because it is very difficult for the BJP to compete in a regionally located party competition, as because the issues that it raises go against or will contradict the BJP's own nationalist position.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
if you were to look at, for example, in Tamil Nadu, when the BJP was when Prime Minister Modi campaigned, he would actually speak of center-state relations. He would speak of not misusing institutions of government. He would speak of India's relationship with Sri Lanka. And he would not speak of anything else. He would not speak about one India or a Hindu India or nationalism, nothing of that sort. He'll play to the gallery in Tamil Nadu.
That's a very interesting thought, because I mean, I'm just thinking back about the Karnataka elections that happened, the assembly elections that happened recently, and the behavior of the Congress party in the context of the Karnataka elections, because you have the JDS, which is perhaps a regionally located party, whereas Karnataka does not have a regionalist party in the same sense that Tamil Nadu does. And so the Congress actually played a very interesting role in the Karnataka elections, where Chief Minister Siddaramaiah wrote about center-state relations in the 15th Finance Commission, and raised also during the, you know, the 5 years that he was Chief Minister, several regional issues around Kannada pride. So in some ways, the Congress in Karnataka behaved like a regionalist party in order to counter some of the narrative of the BJP.
Yes, I think that was one way in which basically to short-circuit the BJP.
That's right,
I think it worked very well, in the sense that it, by occupying that space, the BJP could now... cannot critique the issues that it's being raising, because it has to work in the same location. At the same time, it could not bring other issues of its own nationalist thing into that debate that is going on. So I think that was a very clever move by Siddaramaiah to raise the issues of flag, language and Karnataka culture and so on and so forth. I think that played was a very effective move to check the BJP in the elections at that point of time.
That's right. And I think it's very useful to have this kind of act category distinction, because it helps us kind of separate the different kinds of regional parties that we have seen in India and why some tend to do better against the BJP than the others. Anyway, on that note, I think we'll have to end this particular episode. Thank you once again, Kailash. Thank you for bearing with us very patiently on this particular episode amid all the technical glitches. And thank you all for tuning in.
Nice talking to you, Alok. Nice talking to you, Sarayu.
Thank you, Kailash.
We'll be back with another episode before the next phase of polling. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta. I'm B50 on Twitter. I am the host of Paisa Paisa, the show that talks money. On my show, I speak to experts from every field of money and finance, from stock markets, equities, debt funds, credit cards, life insurance, every possible area of money and finance that you can think of. We even did an episode on cryptocurrency. I've got fantastic guests from mutual funds to personal finance experts everywhere, robo-advisory startups, just name it, we've got it. At Paisa Paisa, we help you make smart decisions about money. You work hard for money. Now make your money work hard for you. New episodes out every Monday, and you can listen to my show on the IVM Podcast app or any other podcasting app that you have. Paisa Paisa is brought to you by Paytm Money.
Sachin Tendulkar, Virat Kohli, Don Bradman, and now Cyrus Brocha. Okay, probably not in the right company. I mean, Don Bradman is Australian. But it's called Cyrus Says, a wonderful show about everything. Find the show on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to podcasts.